This is the Pebble connections task. It's a connect the dots task, and it's a version of the what's called the trail making task, which is a very famous task. This is a task that a version of it was originally developed by Salthouse in about 2000, based on previous tasks. I think maybe one called the Pathfinder task or something like that. And unlike the trail making task, which you can see other videos for, where the targets are sort of a random display, or they're a very specific display in the original trail making task that you draw lines between, this is designed to eliminate some of the confounds with having to move, a long ways to find the next one. Now, the original trail making task is pretty bad because the two versions of it have very different complexity. One's much harder than the other, even without the switching. This is intended to measure something about executive function, in that some of these have very straightforward mappings A, B, C, D, and others make you switch repeatedly between numbers and letters, or letters and numbers. So here's a simple one, and the thing about the connections task is the next one is always adjacent to it, and so originally there may even have been a responses with a keypad. I can't do this while I'm talking, obviously, but so this is designed to model Salthouse's original connections task. It's designed to be maybe a little better version that's more consistent of trail making task. Unfortunately, it has a terrible name, connections. It's almost meaningless. If you search for connections in Google, connections task in Google, you don't get anything like this task. That may be one of the reasons why it isn't as popular, even though it's probably better than the standard trail making task that appears in many test batteries. But the task, let's see, the basic task, you get 20 seconds to complete as many of these as possible. It starts with a 7x7 grid, so there's 49 different points, and you get 20 seconds. Now you can adjust this so you can give as much time as you want, then you can look at how long it takes, but typically you look at how many targets you hit within a limited amount of time. The task involves much less mouse movement and a very limited search area, so it maybe is eliminates a lot of the motor and visual search, and hopefully be more sensitive to the switching. These are some of the reasons why Salthouse preferred it, especially since he was often studying elderly who may not have as good motor control or as good experience using keyboard or mice. And here's a so what it will do is have a complete letter version, it'll have a complete number version, and it'll have number letter swaps. Some of them are letter number and some of them are number letter. By default, well, actually not by default, the task creates four patterns that go from here to here, and it gives each pattern twice, but the second time it gives it, it transposes it, so down becomes over and over becomes down, so hopefully the participant doesn't recognize the pattern that well. On one of the times, of the two times each one is given, it gives a pure, so either all letters or all numbers, and the other time it gives a swap, letter, number, or number, letter, number, letter. So that's a total of eight trials for 20 seconds. That's 2.5 minutes, plus practice could be 3 minutes. And it's with that many, it's pretty reliable. You get a pretty good switch cost every time, at least if you're not sitting and talking while you're doing it. And so it can be pretty sensitive. So here's letter, number. notice how I can click on the wrong thing, it will count how many clicks I make and record that as an outcome. So I don't think it, if I don't click on a circle, I don't think it counts it. But if you make a misclick on the wrong thing, it will count that, and so you can also then compute errors. You can see how many errors someone makes. Here's another swap, A1A, 2B, 3C, 4D, 5E, 6F, 7G, 8H, 9I, 10J, 11K, 12L, 13M, 14N, 15. Okay, we have two more trials. Here's a pure trial. Let's see how far through this I can get in 20 seconds. Okay, so I almost got through the whole thing. You could see that after, because there's 49, it's about two alphabets worth. So when you're swapping between letters and numbers, you can, that's fine because you'll have 52 options. If you're doing just numbers, you can go 1 to 49. But if you're doing letters, I had to come up with a way of specifying the first through the second round, so I use a little star beside each one. And many people never, you know, unless they're really motivated or really fast in practice, they never make it to the second alphabet, or they make it through a few characters of the second alphabet, especially older participants. And so that probably doesn't matter too much. We've got one more to do, and these aren't, this is a number, so you can see it goes all the way up to 49. And then we'll, okay, so I had a number of misclicks there that we'll be able to look at. Okay. At the end, it gives us this little table, which is also saved to a file. So you can see that there were four trials that were switches and four trials that were single. And this is how many targets I made in each one of them. And I wasn't completely paying attention, but I was able to make 22 and a half on average targets when it was a single character, and 18.25 when it was a switch. And remember, these are the same layouts, the same four layouts, but just rotated, so it has exactly the same sort of complex problem complexity. RT here, it had a time limit of 20, so you know, to the it was a few milliseconds off because that's just how the timer sometimes works. But these won't be different unless you finish the whole thing. So if you were to change the time limit to be longer, or the targets problem to be smaller, you might have people complete the whole thing and then use RT as a measure. Generally, with the settings it's given, these will be identical. And here's clicks and overclicks. I had actually 15 overclicks for both trials because I was talking while I was doing it. And this 15 total across all of them, and this shows the overclicks is, or the number of clicks is more than the number of targets I hit. So I clicked more often than I hit the target in each of these cases. Generally, the overclicks here is a lot larger than the overclicks here, but not always. In this case, it was the same. Okay, so that's the basic task, and let's look at the data that appear. That was participant 11. We'll take a brief look at that, the files that I just created, but we'll look at maybe a previous, we'll look at 10 because this is probably better data. So that report that we saw, let me look at 9. The report we saw at the end, that's going to be printed out here too, is saved in this file. So it tells us a timestamp, the grid size, the time limit, participant code, and then the same data. This is the data for a large, for maybe more, more serious when I wasn't talking. And here, the single versus switch had a pretty large ratio. 65% of switch had, I produced 65% of the clicks as I did in single. I had one overclick in single, but 10 overclicks total in the switch case for a difference of 9. So not only am I clicking more, I'm making more mistakes in the switch task. The main data, that's sort of a summary data, but there's a few other ways the data are saved. This one, just the connections dash subnum, gives a lot of detail for each trial. So there were 8 trials here. Subject number 9, I have the type of the problem, and at least with probably after version 2.1 of Pebble, you can see the trial in order, and then the ID. The ID specifies which of the specific problems that was repeated. So 4 and 4 here are exactly the same problem, and so you can compare then the type. This one was a letter number, that was a switch, and this was a number only. So you can see in number only, I made 43, and in letter number I made 25. So that's the sort of difference for this exactly the same problem. There are a couple other statistics that might be interesting. So the sum of some things may make these problems easier or more difficult. This tells you how long the path was that you made. This tells you the angle of all the sums. So if you're clicking in a straight line, the angle, that angle is 0, but if you're going at a 45 degree angle versus a 90 degree angle, this is the sum of all of these, maybe measured in radians or I forget exactly what, but the idea would be the larger, the more the larger, the more complicated, but this is also a sum, so you'd have to divide by the total number of the length in order to see if that path is somehow more complicated. Some options are always going to be the same. It's just the number of options at each click. Sometimes you have 3, sometimes you have 2, but if you think about it, if you go through the whole problem, the sum is always going to be identical. There's an entropy score too. This is very much like the angle sum. It's an entropy score at each point about how many things you can click on. Now, if you look at 4, these two are different. And these are typically going to be different because well, first of all, the more things you click, that adds to the overall entropy. But if you look at entropy per click, it's also going to be different because sort of the problem opens up as you get to the middle of it, into the wider space, so it tends to have more entropy. So the farther, typically what you'll see is even if you divide by the number of points, there's still an effect which stems from sort of the nature of, even for the same problem, it gets more entropy as you go forward. Here's the total number of clicks made. Here's the last click. This is the last thing you succeeded at making, which is going to be identical to this. Response time and overall time. These are, I guess this is overall time is, it's probably from when you first saw the problem, and this is the total time given. So this could be several seconds longer if you're looking at it. Here I looked at it for about 5 seconds before I started. And then there's a, it actually shows you what the specific problem is. So if you count the grid, 7 by 7 horizontally, first in columns, then in rows, you can number those 1 through 49. And this will just tell you the specific path of the problem. So if you want to do more analytics, you could. You have all of these specific locations. All right, so you could do a specific examination of each problem by looking at those. So that's one row per problem, but we even have more detailed ones, and we'll just look at the path. The practice is identical for some practice problems we'll look at in just a second. as well. So here, each problem has its, each click has its own row. I get a time for every click. I get whether I'm correct or not. And a bunch of statistics, the size of the problem and stuff. Actually, I've updated that. We'll look at here. If we look at the practice, so it has headers that are a little more easier to interpret. So you see each problem, the trial, the problem that, which of the four specific problems, the number and letter, the row and column of the click, the x and y coordinates of the click, what they clicked on, this is a consecutive click counter, and so on. So these could be also used to do much more detailed analytics. Like you could look at this every specific error, like here's an error, here's an error, here's an error. Was there a delay afterwards? Was it in cases that were particularly difficult? And so you could analyze all of that if you wanted to. Most people will probably look at just these numbers or do some analysis on these values. Okay, so that's the basic task. Now, there's a few parameters you can edit. We select the task and hit edit. There's an input device method, I think, but it doesn't matter. I think if you're using a touch screen, this might have at one time the idea would have been to use different instructions if you use touch screen, but I don't think I ever implemented that. You can specify the width, height, and time limits, so we can look at maybe a smaller problem or a larger problem. Like we could give for a 5x5, 30 seconds to finish a 5x5. And we'll save that and return and see what it looks like. Now, when I first started, I didn't show you this, but it starts with some practice trials. It starts with a 4x4 practice, one of each type. So it does a pure one first, and then it does an alternating 1, 1, A, 2, B, 3, C, 4, D, 5, E, 6, 7, 8, H. Okay, now we're gonna get the whole grid. One of the, and so this is design is more like the traditional trail making task where you solve the whole problem and we time you. The connections task, it was sort of designed to give you a time limit to solve as much as you can, and that might be a little more stable or a little more sensitive, but this is the alternate. So here we have an all letter task. Let's see if I can finish it in 30 seconds. So you see, I finish it, and then I get the next one, 1A, 2B, 3, 5E, 6F, 7G, 8I, 8H, 9I, 11K, 12L. Okay, so I'll stop there. In that case, it's not going to create the whole data file. But the summary file, but it will do the click by click and it'll give us a row for each one. So in just those two, you can see that the time was let's see, the overall time was 12 seconds here, 12.8 seconds, and 17 5 seconds for the switch one. So that's a an alternate measure of sort of throughput or something. And if you do that, then maybe the entropy scores are actually going to be more interesting because they both solve the whole problem and you can have equivalent problems that you assess rather than just partial problems. The angle sum and some of these might be more interesting looking at cross problems if you do that. Okay, so the last thing to look at is that there's some translations you can do. These are pretty minimal, but if I hit connections and translate task, it'll take me to this dialog which specifies these different footers for the different things. This is like the first and second part of a footer of trial X. Click screen to begin. Different instructions. And so on. And you could adapt these instructions yourself or translate them to a new language if you want to use them in a new language. All right, that is a basic overview of the Pebble Connections task. It's sort of an alternative to the trail making task that is probably better than a lot of versions of the trail making task. It removes some of the visual search and motor confounds in the trail making task to make it more equivalent for populations that may differ on those, like children or older people. It also is nice in that we use the same problem, the same layout, in both the switch and non-switch versions, so this is a much fairer comparison of the executive function. I also do that in the Pebble trail making task as well. And we have multiple rounds of this, so the measure is much more stable than you get with the standard trail making task, which is just a single problem done once. And also, the problems are not equivalent. You have one, in the standard trail making, A is much easier than B, even without the letter switching. So that's an overview of the task. Feel free to use it and download it from pebble.sourceforge.net. It's free and part of the Pebble test battery under Pe battery connections.